the top 7 overlooked factors in the treatment of Lyme disease.
We've been treating chronic Lyme disease complex for about 2 decades, at least over a decade where we've been really doing a lot of R&D. And so the information we're giving you here is from our clinical experience of treating thousands of patients. Here's what we see kind of go wrong. Number one, the patient isn't fully diagnosed. That means they'll come in and they'll go, oh, I ran a Western blot, or I think I have Lyme disease. I don't know what my co-infections are from the tick. I don't know what my secondary co-infections are. I don't know what the state of my immune system is. I don't know what my chemical and heavy metal toxins are. So essentially, they don't have a complete diagnosis. If you don't know what all the infections are, you can't treat them all, right? For example, antibiotics may work on some bacteria, but they're not going to work on the viral part. So you need a complete comprehensive diagnosis. But that doesn't ensure that you're going to get a correct treatment plan. Because in most of the treatment plans, whether you're using a natural product or you're using a drug like an antibiotic or whatever, the latent Lyme disease, the chronic versions of Lyme disease, these complexes we're talking about, they are resistant to treatment. They have MDR, multi-drug resistance, and you need to be able to shut down that resistance. So we have to use adjunctive treatments to help fight those infections. They'll also have biofilm communities around them, making them very hard to penetrate. But essentially, when you have biofilm, which is like a, we use the term sludge, but it's like a matrix that basically surrounds the infection so they can live and not be touched by antibiotics very effectively or by the immune system. So they have to be stripped during treatment. And then making it a little bit more complex, some of these infections are in the blood-brain barrier. So if you have neuroborreliosis, babesia, these are not only multi-drug resistant, but then they're in the blood-brain barrier, and you have to have treatment methodologies to get the medication into the blood-brain barrier to effectively kill those infections. But you have to be able to shuttle that medicine. Otherwise, you don't get the memory fog improved, you don't get some of the Parkinsonian tremor symptoms, some of these other issues, neurological symptoms, even mood, depression, anxiety, all these things that can be coming from chronic Lyme disease complex. Remember, Lyme is the cousin of syphilis. They're both spirochetes. And, you know, oftentimes if you study late stage syphilis, they have a lot of psychiatric symptoms. Well, in chronic Lyme disease patients, you do see psychiatric symptoms. Very important to treat them. These infections wreak havoc on the body because they produce endotoxins, biotoxins, basically are toxins by the infection to shut down the nervous system and the hormonal systems in the body. And that's the way the parasite is trying to shut down the organism. I'll give you a visual. In Maine, up northern Maine, you have these moose that die every year because they'll get bit by a bunch of ticks, they'll get overwhelmed by these toxins, and they'll take down thousands of pounds of an animal and then basically eat or you know, devour what's there because they are parasitic. They're trying to survive off that organism. But when they release these endotoxins, they're designed to paralyze. They're designed to block hormonal systems and cause issues in the body. And when patients have HLA-DRs, which are a genomic gene thing, they have a higher susceptibility to autoimmune diseases. You start putting these things together, and you'll see how a lot of patients can shift into autoimmunity with a combination of infections and the right genomic SNPs that play a role in there. So you have to flush these endotoxins and biotoxins out of the body while you're treating the infection. And when a patient is on pain medication, because they've been in pain and doctors haven't been able to treat them except for manage their pain, it becomes harder because they're competing for the same receptor sites as those endotoxins and biotoxins, trying to get to the same receptor site. So you're trying to flush out the toxins, and those medications play a role in the recovery. And finally, the key, the long-term key, is to reestablish the immune system. So not only necessarily just making it stronger, but letting the immune system recognize these biotoxins, endotoxins in the body, and also reestablishing the immune system so it can target particularly a lot of the antiviral components, which are cause a lot of the fatigability, a lot of what things people call, you know, fatigue that you see with a lot of the virus components, and also a part of the viral co-infections, and also the immune system being reestablished with the parasitic, fungal, and bacterial parts of these chronic Lyme disease patients. So this is a lot that's going on. I'm just giving you an overview. So when I say there, you know, these are the 7 things, the complexity of chronic Lyme disease is beyond the care of a basic integrative practice. It's beyond the care really of conventional because they don't specialize in it and they don't see enough of these cases. So you have to be working with a medical center that's, this is what they do, and it's pretty much one of the main things that they do. And that's what we've been doing for several decades. And we just wanted to help educate, give some knowledge to some of the patients out there so they have a little better idea of how complex this is and the different things that need to be done to help the patient.